So this is joint work with Thomas Calment and Nabil Layada from the Tyrex research team at INRIA and the Laboratoire d'informatique de Grenoble, LIG, as well as with Marion Lepellet, Svetlana Artemova, and Jean-Luc Bosson from the Public Health Department of the CHU Grenoble-Alpes. So basically, the talk I'm proposing here is a journey in big data for healthcare. So healthcare is a domain in which we can have access to very diverse data sources with data coming from sensors, prescriptions, genome, and as you are going to see in a minute, also clinical data and billing data. So there is a wide range of promising big data applications that can be classified according to their technological complexity and also impact, basically. So actually, we started this work with a few questions in mind. In particular, we wondered what were the challenges associated with the construction of such a big data application. So are those challenges rather on the mathematical side, rather statistical, or rather in computer science? So to bring some elements of answers to those questions, we proposed a predictive analytics use case and addressed it. So this use case is about the prediction of adverse effects. So an adverse effect is basically an undesired, harmful effect resulting from medical care. So hospital-acquired infections, admissions in intensive care units, pressure ulcers, and in the worst case, death, constitute examples of adverse effects. So we are interested in prediction, especially because according to physicians, almost half of adverse effects are clearly or likely preventable. However, for this to be possible, there is a crucial and hard requirement, which is to be able to precisely identify at-risk profiles. So with such a precise identification, we could probably avoid some adverse effects. And more generally, for instance, if we can predict that some person is at very high risk of ICU admission, then we can probably put him or her in a room which is closer to ICU at admission, for instance. This is just an example. So the problem we are considering here is, can we predict on the day of hospital admission future occurrence of adverse effects? Okay, so there were some previous studies about this. And basically, in the state of the art, the most commonly used approach is to use scalar aggregates, or scores if you prefer, computed from electronic health records. So the MRCI, for Medication Regimen Complexity Index, is an example of such a score. So it is known already that higher level of this kind of scores at admission are known to be correlated with higher risks of complication. Okay. So there are, however, a lot of open questions remaining. And the main question we'll be considering here is, what if, instead of designing aggregates, we use whole high-resolution data available to build predictive models? Okay, is it feasible? Is it scalable? And how fast? Can we measure the effect of volume and variety of big data in this context? And what are the computing bottlenecks in practice? So the rest, the outline of the rest of my presentation is as follows. So first, I will give you an overview of the system that we developed using distributed machine learning. Then I will report on some of our experimental results with data coming from millions of patients. And then I'll try to bring some elements of answers to the previous questions. So first, there are some key methodological aspects in our work. So first, we start from the initial postulate that drug prescription data on the day of admission contain rich information about not only the patient's situation, but also its the perspectives of evolution for this patient. An important one also is that we assume no prior clinical knowledge when defining features that will be used for machine learning, okay? So instead, we rely on supervised machine learning algorithms to extract this information. Obviously, we will evaluate the quality of our models using rather conventional performance metrics, such as the area under the rock curve, precision, accuracy, and other metrics on real imbalanced test sets. And we will also have a look at running times for distributed execution as well. So here is an overview of the system we developed. So basically, we use a laptop to run a web browser to interact with a notebook that is executed on a driver machine from which we access a cluster of 150 cores that work in parallel together and that run distributed implementations of supervised machine learning algorithms, okay, to ensure scalability when we construct models. So we use a full stack of technologies like Spark, Spark ML, Docker, Jupyter Notebooks, Python, and Scala, for instance. So the data we consider are taken from the Premier Perspective database of 2006, which is an American database with data coming from 417 hospitals in the USA with more than 33 million of admissions and more than 3 billion patient billing records. So this means that we have everything from the most complex surgery operation to the simplest pill, okay? Basically everything that can be billed, okay? We are in the US. And we can analyze this, okay? So one legitimate question is that big data? Well, the answer is I don't know because I don't have a formal definition for big data. However, what I can tell is about our experience with the cost of the initial data preparation. So to prepare data for further analysis, we had to compute big joints. And at first, we tried to compute those big joints in a centralized manner, so on a single server. And we finally stopped the computation after a few hours because the total time for completion was around 6 days, okay? Whereas we implemented a distributed algorithm to compute those joints and the total computation time was around 2 minutes, okay? So this is the reason why we use a distributed architecture for performing supervised machine learning. So the data we consider are composed of billing records that we have filtered and joined to be enriched with patient information. So for the features, we extract them from patient information. So we consider, for instance, the age, the gender, the admission type for a given patient, and also all data related to drug prescription on the day of admission. So I will come back to the definition of features in a minute. For labels, we consider Boolean labels for each considered adverse effect. So a Boolean is true whenever the adverse effect actually occurred. We tried several models for binary classifications, including decision trees, random forests, super vector machines, logistic regressions, and we are also playing a little bit with deep neural networks lately. So if we zoom on the features that we considered, we defined, so basically there are so many of them, so we defined categories of features. So the first one, which we named B, is a list of basic patient features consisting of, for instance, age, gender, admission type. For the purpose of comparison with earlier works, we will consider a particular feature which is called M, which is the aggregate score corresponding to MRCI at admission. Okay, so this is the only very simple category consisting of only one Scala aggregate. And more interestingly, we consider P, for instance, which is the list of all drugs, of all categories of drugs that were served on the first day. Okay, we will also consider an even longer list of all detailed drug names that have been served on the first day. The difference between P and C being that in C, distinct variants of drugs are distinguished. Okay, so depending on the on the quantity, okay? For instance, I will come back on this in a minute. So those are the main feature categories that we are considering, and we will be considering combinations of them so that to introduce models of increasing granularity. Okay. So typically, when I will talk about a BMP model here, for instance, this means that we are considering both B, also M, and also P, okay, as feature categories. So you will observe that the number of features can be large, quite large in our models, since the length of P is typically greater than 2000, and the length of C is greater than 10,000. So what we do is essentially binary classification in large dimensions. So if we recall the simple academic example in two dimensions, basically learning a model means learning a line to try to separate our two classes of points, okay? And whenever we receive a new data point, then we can use our model to make a prediction. Well, this is exactly the same principle, but in more than 10,000 dimensions, okay? So here is a sample feature vector in the BMC model, where you can see, for instance, the few basic features, and you can see some drugs that have been served on the first day. Okay. So here are the first results. So this is a ROC curve. So I guess that everybody here knows how to read a ROC curve. So basically, the higher the curve, the more accurate the model is in making prediction, okay? And if you're along the diagonal, this means that your model basically is not, it's just a dice, okay? So what we can observe here is that using just the set of basic features plus the aggregate score, the typical MRCI aggregate score, we are just, let's say, slightly better than a dice for making predictions, okay? Whereas when we consider drugs categories and drugs detailed drugs variants, there is a significant increase, okay, in accuracy for making prediction. So now we can look at the impact of volume. So it's also for making predictions of HAI, so hospital acquired infections. So we made several experiments. So first, we kept a constant ratio between the trained set and the test set and make both of them vary, increase in size. And we can observe that, we can observe several metrics, and they all tend to show that the more volume, okay, the more accuracy you get in making predictions. We can also consider a fixed test set and increase successively the size of the training set, and we will also observe that increased volume basically tends to yield greater error under the ROC curve and greater recall as well. So we considered several different adverse effects and obtained several areas under the ROC curves. So basically, our models, our predictive models, work better for predicting hospital-acquired infections and pressure ulcers, but we can still use them for predicting death, and so they perform a little bit less for predicting ICU admissions. So now let's have a look at the total computational cost when building our models. So here we look at the cost of performing a three-cross validation of building a logistic regression model. Okay, so on this surface here, you can see the total computational cost depending on the number of patients in the training set and also on the number of features considered in our model. So if I take a particular point on this surface here, I can zoom on the breakdown of the costs corresponding to each computation step. So in order, we first compute several splits to perform the three cross validation. So we extract a train set, then we extract a test set, we prepare the features, and then we fit the model. Okay. So I observe more or less here a distribution of the cost, which is more or less preserved if I now move on the surface, so that I consider 7 times more instances in the train set, approximately. Okay, so still, the distribution of the cost of each computation step is more or less the same. So now, what happens if I move in this direction on the surface, meaning that I'm considering 5 times more features, then I can see now that the dominating cost starts to be the cost of optimization algorithms, okay, to learn the model. So more generally, if I consider the scalability, if I look at the scalability with hardware resources, and if I observe the total running time for constructing and performing cross-validation of our BMP models here, in terms of the number of cores in our cluster, and also in terms of the amount of RAM per executor in our cluster, then I obtain this kind of graph here, okay, where each color corresponds to a given amount of RAM per worker in our cluster, okay. So we can see a sharp decrease at first, until we reach something like 48 cores, and then afterwards the decrease is much slower, okay? So what is interesting to notice on this graph is that it's still possible to set resources in an appropriate manner to maintain an interactive session for the domain expert, okay? So the clinical scientist, if you prefer, so that you can manipulate millions of instances, you know, in less, let's say, then less than 400 seconds, provided you consider at least 48 cores, for instance. So, however, you will notice probably some strange behavior. So the first one is that if we look closely, performance with 44 cores and 144 cores here for the maximum amount of RAM per executor is almost similar. Okay, the performances are almost similar, which is at first kind of strange, right? And even worse than that, if you look closely here, we increase the number of cores and this worsened performance. Same thing here. We went from 128 cores to 144 cores and observed that the performance is worse. Okay. So how come this is possible? How come this is possible? What happens here? Well, when you do distributed computing, data partitioning matters very much. So what happens here is that when you consider more cores in your cluster, obviously you get more computational power. But you also get more partitions, more data partitions, okay? Which means potentially more data shuffling, more data transfer on the network between the workers. So on the opposite, when you consider less cores, then you have less partitions and less data transfer. So this means that we have to find non-trivial balances between computational power and data partitioning, basically. So to conclude on this use case, I would say that first, the initial postulate from which we started seems reasonable, since basically massive drug prescription data help in making predictions. So the more variety, the greater model accuracy that you get, but this is not systematic, okay? Whereas for volume, the more volume you have in your analysis, the greater model accuracy we obtain in practice. We can also say that acceptable running times, and by acceptable I mean a time which is acceptable for the domain expert to use an interactive session for interacting and processing a million of instances and thousands of features. To keep this within reasonable bounds, then we have to look for a good distribution of data and computations. So you will be able to find many more details on this study in this article that's just got out, so in Big Data Research, as of March 2018, and which is available online. So there are some interesting perspectives, I think, for further work in this direction. So first, it would be interesting to do a clinical interpretation of the models that we have obtained, in particular since simple models such as logistic regressions are intelligible and the weights we obtain are rather stable. It would be interesting to consider more sophisticated features and models as well, more data, obviously. We can imagine plenty of things like joining with drug molecular compositions or weather data, or whatever. And a more on a more general computer science perspective, here what I tried to show in practice on a sample application is that basically the traditional complexity theory that we have in computer science reveals inappropriate. To indicate the cost of a distributed application because of data transfer in particular. So what we want to do is to design cost models for this kind of distributed data-driven applications. And since scalability is not trivial to obtain, what we want to do also is we are investigating the design of optimizing compilers, okay, so that we can efficiently generate the distributed code automatically, having guarantees, correctness and efficiency guarantees on the generated code. So this is exactly what we do in the CLEAR research project. So thank you for your attention.